Good morning. I'm Chris Cowan, and I'm doing the children's time for y'all for the second Sunday in Advent. Advent is a cool word. It means to come. And you think of the word adventure, and it's of exciting things to come in your life. Well, the Advent, the thing that's coming for us, is the birth of Jesus. And there's different ways to get ready. And I'm going to share some things my family has done through the years. And you guys can do some of the same things. So there's things like Advent calendars, there's Advent wreaths, there's nativity scenes, and several of these are all mentioned in the Advent devotional and Advent packet that you can get from the church if you haven't already. Here are some of the things my family has used. I'll go back over them in a minute. One is an Advent calendar. Another is part of a nativity set. This one was one my brother gave my boys when they were little. Over here, I have a fancier wooden one that I bought at annual conference, and it's made of wood from olive trees from Israel. Another one is this Advent wreath. And then in the back, I have two different Christmas trees that I'm going to kind of keep track of several things. So one, this Advent calendar, you open the first flap on December 1st. And since I'm recording this on December 3rd, I have three flaps open. And they can have treats behind them. This one does happen to have some chocolates behind it. I'm kind of fond of these kind of calendars because every year when I was a child, my grandparents in Germany would send us one from there. And we used to kind of fight over it until Mama got smart and gave us a rotation, told us you were first, yours next day, etc. And we got better about not arguing. Another type of way to count down, instead of getting a treat, is something that we mentioned in our Advent packet and devotional guide that we gave out, and that's to do a reverse Advent calendar. And as you count down, in this case, you count the things you've added to a box of food items for the church pantry. So I'm using this straw tree, and I'm adding the numbers 1 through 24 until we have Christmas Eve arriving. And then I'll have a box of food to give to the church food pantry. So that's something we hope y'all are going to consider doing. My other tree is, again, numbers on it, 1, 2, 3, etc. And I'm putting them on for the days as I read the Advent devotional and say a prayer or do a good deed for someone. When I was a child, our church had a manger set up between the church and the school building. And every time you did something good for somebody or you said a prayer, you added a piece of straw. Actually, it was sticks, if I remember right. And so hopefully by the time Christmas Eve came and the baby Jesus was going to come, they could add him to the scene into the manger and he would have a soft place ready for him. This other one is, I already talked about that one. So we'll move over here. Here's the Advent wreath. This wreath, my boys and husband and I made when we went to a church back in League City 25 years ago or more. And we've been using it religiously ever since. And we did a workshop last year that made some more maybe pretty ones, but this was what we came up with. The evergreen represents the eternal God, and the candles have meaning. The three candles that are purple represent God's kingdom and his eternal being And the pink one is the joy candle, or for Gaudete Sunday, the third Sunday in Advent. And when we're 1 week away, 1 Sunday away from Jesus's arrival, the candle in the middle, Reverend Michelle talked about it last week, is the one that represents the Christ child. And a lot of people don't light it until the last day on Christmas Day. But Michelle, or Pastor Michelle, I should say, was saying she liked to have it lit because it represented the God and Christ, and that the other candles could be lit from it. So I lit mine on this one, and it's usually white to signify the purity and the dignity of our Lord. Now, turn a little bit sideways here so you can kind of see everything I've got in one place. Whoops, you're seeing my ugly ironing board. But we're hoping you'll think about some of these things and do it. There's other things you could do in the packet. There's, if you're more artistic and want to, you could make yourself a felt Christmas tree and add ornaments, the chrismons, which we gave you patterns for. They are symbols, Christ symbols, so chrismons. And they have been around since the 1800s when a lady at a church came up with them, and they're usually made out of felt, or white at least, with gold. White again for the purity of Jesus, and gold for his royalty. So there's some meanings behind all of those. Another thing mentioned in there, and I really want to try it myself for next year, is to do a Jesse tree. And a Jesse tree tracks all the people from the lineage of Jesse that Jesus is from, people that were part of his life. And there's a Bible reading and a symbol to go with the person that is related to Jesus that's mentioned in that Bible verse. And I think that would be a really neat thing to do as a church, to maybe do a separate tree from the beautiful chrismon tree that we have. I'm hoping that you'll take a look at our chrismon tree. I think it's going to be out on Christmas Eve night, so we can hope. I'm going to read a little blessing and stuff from a sheet or a candle cover thing we had when my boys were younger. We've got different Sundays in Advent. It went around the thing. And this one has another little take on the names for the candles. They called the first one, the first week in Advent, they said it was the prophecy candle. And then the second week was the Bethlehem candle. And the third week was the shepherd's candle, and the fourth, the angel's candle. So I'm going to read what was the reading for the second week that year. Let me hold that up here. And it says, the Bethlehem candle is a symbol of the preparation being made to receive and cradle the Christ child. May our hearts be ready to receive the good news. And the reading that day was from Micah 5:2. But you, Bethlehem, the least of the clans of Judah, from you will come for me the future ruler of Israel, whose origins have been of old, from everlasting. So, I hope you have a good week and you think about doing some of the things, especially maybe the food pantry, because this coming time, yes, it's going to be fun to get gifts yourself, but we hope you think about others. Bless you all. Bye-bye.
Good morning, church. It is good to be with you on this second Sunday of Advent. Welcome into this time of worship where we give ourselves to the Lord and we hear and receive by God's Holy Spirit. We do have just a couple of announcements, some reminders of the things we have going on this Advent up here at the church. We are in the middle, well, not even the middle, isn't that funny? It's only the 6th of December, and I feel like we're already halfway through the month. It's just the way this year is gone. But we are preparing for our outdoor event. Hopefully you've been receiving our daily Advent devotionals written by members of the congregation, or you've picked up your written copy or received your PDF copy. They have been profoundly beautiful and a huge blessing to hear the hearts of the members of our church and how this year has been transformed by their faith and the way their faith is transforming them. I pray that you are blessed by them as well. And as we prepare, moving into December, our December 18th and 19th outdoor event, it'll be drive-through living Christmas cards that have been prepared by members of the church, UTRG Church Farm, our Cub Scout troop. So we pray that you will come out, bring your friends, maybe take a few pictures, and reconnect with the community and enjoy the gift of grace and joy and laughter this season. Our scholarship students will be caroling and sharing some music. It'll be a great time. I pray that you will come out, that you will invite your friends, that you'll come out as a neighborhood, and see what all joy we can share together. Our food pantry distribution will be December 19th. That's the third Saturday at 11 a.m. We're working on doing an expanded food pantry distribution. Usually during Christmas or Advent, we focus on a global mission to share in as a community. But with the rising need of food insecurity and the rising need to receive within our local community, we decided to focus this year on our own community. So similar to the food boxes we've done in the past during Lent, and this year we're doing one at Christmas, and we need your support. The total cost of a box, which is actually two boxes and some canned goods, is approximately $50. Buster Lynn is putting together a produce box, and Chorizo San Manuel is putting together a food box, and then we'll have additional things to contribute from our reverse Advent calendars and food drive. So I pray that you'll be a part of that. You can give online specifically for that. Soon, we have a very specific website. If you purchased pumpkin bread online this October, November, we're going to be doing a similar format so that you can take care of that online very specifically, and it will give you a place to note whether or not it is in celebration or honor or in memory of someone, and contact them as well if you have your email address for them. So be on the lookout for that. I'll be sending an email either today or tomorrow with all of those details and how we can participate and give in a very generous form that our community needs and can receive with grace. Christmas Eve, we are still on track to, weather permitting, worship together outdoors. And so we will have a service with candlelight and communion at 6:30 p.m. on Christmas Eve. We still have a few of the Advent activity packets available, and so if you have not picked one up yet, you can contact the church office and make sure that someone is here, and we can either get them to you or you can come and pick it up here. And now, one of the most important parts of our liturgy and of our worship together is how we stay connected even though we are far apart, and that is with the passing of the peace. We can't reach out and hug each other or shake hands right now, but what we can do is enter in our blessing in the comment thread. So if you would greet each other and bless each other in the peace and grace of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Our lists are long, even in this strange mess where we live these days. And we want to do it right. We want to be safe, but we want to be able to enjoy the season. We've got work to do to put right what has gone wrong, to heal what is broken, to mend the relationships, and to prepare for the company that will come.
The prophet Isaiah reminds us that there is work to be done. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. When God comes in, then healing is to be found. But we need to make the way. We need to open the door into our lives.
So we light these candles as a sign of our faith that the God we worship is not far from us and that we can clear the way for that God to come and dwell with us. We light these candles in faith that company is coming.
Come, O come, Emmanuel.
Hail to the Lord's anointed, great David's greater son. Hail in the time appointed, his reign on earth begun. He comes to break oppression, to set the captive free. To take away transgression and rule in equity. He comes with succor speedy to those who suffer wrong, to help the poor and needy and bid the weak be strong. To give them songs for sighing, their darkness turn to light. Whose souls condemned and dying are precious in his sight. To him shall prayer unceasing and daily vows ascend. His kingdom still increasing, a kingdom without end. This tide of time shall never his covenant remove. His name shall stand forever, that name to us is love.
We believe in God, creator and lover of the earth, origin and destiny of us all. We believe in Jesus the Christ, God coming to us in the fragile promise of a baby yet unborn, who emerges as the herald of hope, God's laughter in the face of despair. Plunged into death and hell, he broke free the captives, and is leading the way to the land of promise, where justice and peace will flourish. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who implants the seed of truth, brings us to birth as the body of Christ, and empowers us to confront and transform all that is corrupt, degrading, and deceitful. We believe in the coming reign of God. Announced by the Baptist, it has drawn near to us in Jesus and will be consummated in the glorious marriage of earth and heaven, when all who have passed through the world's deep sorrow will be raised from the waters, robed in righteousness, and gathered into the joyous fulfillment of God's desire. For the coming of that day, on this day, we work and pray. Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Our scriptures this morning come from the Gospel of Luke and the Gospel of Matthew. Our Luke text is chapter 1, verses 26 through 38, and then Matthew 1, 18 through 25. Listen now for the word of the Lord. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. The kingdom will never end." Mary asked the angel, "But how can this happen? I am a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say that she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her sixth month. For the word of God will never fail." Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And then the angel left her. And then from the Gospel of Matthew. This is how Jesus the Messiah was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Joseph, to whom she was engaged, was a righteous man and did not want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement quietly. As he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. "Joseph, son of David," the angel said, "do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. "Look, the virgin will conceive a child, and she will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded and took Mary as his wife. But he did not have sexual relations with her until her son was born, and Joseph named him Jesus. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Today, we talk about faith. And somehow, it becomes very intermingled with this word hope that we discussed last week, the hope of the world, the holy waiting, the anticipating, the work of holy waiting, what we do. But faith is just a little bit different, and maybe it's our faith that allows us to hope. Our belief that God is who God says God is, and that God does what God says God will do. We believe. We know in this deep place the truth of the Lord. We hold tightly to it. We cling to it. We wait for it. We expect it. It's more than hope in this sense that, you know, we're doing this holy waiting, but faith is a knowledge. It is an assurance of the things we have yet to see. simply because God speaks them. We know that they are done. That's why I love that verse, the word of the Lord never fails. If it's been spoken, it will happen. And so we wait to see. Waiting is not my gift. I'm just going to hold that out there. Patience, not my thing. I learn it. I work at it. But there's always this underlying bubble that's just like, hurry up. I'm that person that stands in front of the microwave and chants, hurry up. Patience, the waiting, the faith, the believing. I know my coffee is going to be warm in less than 30 seconds. I know it. It doesn't stop me from standing in front and chanting. This faith, this knowledge. But it's more than anticipation. The seeing. I know what's working in my microwave. I don't always know. I can't always see how God is working. Were he that transparent, things might be simpler. And so when we look at the story of Mary and the story of Joseph, I like that this year we get to hold them together at the same time. Mary is visited by an angel, and the angel tells her, don't be afraid. And the angel tells Joseph, don't be afraid. And whenever an angel says, don't be afraid, go ahead and be afraid. It means something bigger than we know how to deal with is headed our way. But if our faith can take root, if we can lean into the strength of our faith, we don't have to be afraid. We don't have to be anxious. And so we have Mary who hears the angel out and in her faith says, may it be done to me. I believe it will be done to me. Yes, she says yes. Of all the things that she has to worry about, all the drama, all the shame, all of the possible repercussions, she says yes. She believes that God will do what God says God will do. She believes in the word of the Lord from the prophets. And if there were ever a time to let doubt sort of creep in, we're talking about 700 years from the word of the prophet to the angel appearing to Mary. But she holds to her faith and says yes. And then we look at Joseph, who will face his own sort of repercussions, who will face his own scandal. Everyone is going to know, to assume, one, that the baby isn't his, or two, that he has behaved in a manner that is inappropriate, and he is a righteous man. The scriptures declare him a righteous man, one whose faith is strong, whose actions are above reproach. And so this will cast a shadow on all of that. But he believes in what the Lord says. He believes that God will do what God says God will do. And he holds more tightly to that, the strength of God's protection, of God's vision and plan, knowing that it is greater than the temporary. Not hoping it's greater than the temporary, knowing it is greater than the temporary. Knowing that what God is doing is bigger and more important than what he's living through in this moment. He says yes. And he goes about and sets things in motion to protect Mary and to protect the prophecy, by the way. Another devout believer who's waited 700 years. Well, I mean, Joseph wasn't 700, but in his faith knows that it has been 700 years since the prophecy, and he holds that prophecy as truth. He knows it. When the angels recount scripture to Mary and Joseph, it isn't the first time they've heard it. It's part of who they are. They know it is true, and their faith transforms the world. Their faith in God. Their faith that God will do what God says God will do. Changes the scope of history forever. want that kind of faith. I want to be so embedded and enmeshed in the scriptures that if an angel ever comes to me and says, do not be afraid, I will swallow a little harder, and then I will wait for the word of the Lord that I recognize, that I know in my inmost being, and I will press into it with strength because my faith will be strong. What is it the Lord is asking me to know? What is the Lord asking you to know today that might transform the world? Things that seem extraordinary and impossible and scandalous. I often wonder what would have happened if Mary and Joseph had been together when the angel appeared. If that would have been simpler somehow. Or if they would have talked each other out of their own yeses. If they were together over a meal, maybe their families were together, and then all the people that we would want to know and believe that we were telling the truth or that we'd seen an angel or that we weren't making things up, we'd have our support system, we'd have our closest people around us, and we wouldn't have to worry about whether or not they believed because they would have seen with their own eyes too. Would have been a comfort? Would the yes have been as easy? Or would they have experienced this encounter with the angel and then talked themselves out of it and said, wow, that was crazy. That was some really bad hummus. We must have had a terrible dream. Haven't you ever been with someone and experienced something just so profound and you talk yourselves out of it being as big a deal as it was? That somehow it was no longer God's intervention, but it was just a happy coincidence or luck, twist of fate. We overlook God's reality and power because we want what's normal. We want what's easy. And so just as much as we hope we might talk each other into saying yes to the Lord, the reality is we'll probably talk each other out of it. But their faith which was able to stand alone, now will stand together. What kind of message is that for us as a church family, as a community of faith, as believers? As we are worshiping together today, there are many on this feed who've never met an actual person who attends in this church. That's crazy to me. But we are bound together by the Holy Spirit, and that makes us family. And so how, in our individual yeses to the Lord, will we stand in strength together as community? As simple as supporting the food pantry distribution. As individuals, we say yes, that we want to feed the hungry. And so together as a community, we make an impact. As individuals, we say yes to supporting the shoe bank and making sure that the children in our community have shoes for the school year. As a community, we make an impact. Our individual yeses have to amount to communal identity and impact. How we stand together in faith, lifting up God's word and God's promises with knowledge, with the understanding, the deep-rooted truth that God will do what God says God will do. Where is your faith today? And maybe the other question is, what is our faith in? What are we holding most tightly to? Where are we drawing our strength from? What crazy thing might the Lord be asking you to do that will cause scandal, that will make those closest to you who know you the best lift an eyebrow and wonder if the year hasn't just had its total impact on you and need to talk you down? What great and amazing thing might your faith bring? How do we become people who transform the world? Some of it has to be just in sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. The faith that Jesus is the Son of God. That the words of the prophets are true. That the words of Scripture are true. That the actions of Mary and Joseph are true. And that they have transformed history. And because they transformed history, they transform you and me. This morning, I looked at a text from a friend. I'd made a post on Facebook earlier in the week that 2020 was working overtime to break me in the final stretch. And to that, I will say, I got up this morning and my car wouldn't start. Like every day this week, there has been some kind of mess. Some of it personal and heartbreaking, some of it inconvenient and overwhelming with the amount of work that will have to be done to overcome it. But every day, just one more thing. And really, does it matter if my car doesn't start? Can I get somebody to jump that battery? Can I find somebody to come pick me up and bring me to church? Can I find somebody to come and take me to AutoZone to replace it? Yes, it's all manageable. But when you have managed so much more than you thought you'd have to, every little thing feels like it weighs 1,000 pounds. And lots of people responded to this post about me feeling like 2020 was working overtime to break me, about how they get it, that they're in the same place, that they're experiencing the same things. But one of my friends, one who I hold so dear, another pastor, a pastor who has mentored me and shepherded me, who's a big brother in every way I can imagine, sent me a message on Facebook and then sent me a text and said, fight back. Push back. Push back against the darkness. Bring joy. Bring hope. Bring faith. Bring joy. Bring peace. Push back. Fight back. Do things that remind people. Stand strong in your faith. Fight back. One of the clips he sent me was a member of their church who is a virtuoso violinist. They went and just stood on the corner outside one of the places where the homeless can receive a meal in downtown Austin and played. He just stood on the corner and played for those who were lined up to receive, for those who were preparing the meals, gave back, pushed back against despair and darkness. Just one person and a violin to offer what they had in the knowledge that God is good and that God brings good and that joy and hope and change and transformation is coming. The faith that we can walk out into a broken, hurting world and bring the kingdom of heaven. Fight back. Stand in your faith. Push back with the goodness of God. Don't fight back in an ugly, snarky way, which could be my default, but to push back in the ways of good and glory and grace. Of redemption and hope. To bring whatever it is God has gifted inside me and share it with the world in faith that it matters. I may never know that there was an eternal difference because I was willing to be obedient, but I don't have to know because it's my gift to the Lord. And it's my faith that God has given me what God has given me for the kingdom and not for myself. That everything I have and all that I am is from the Lord and it's for the Lord. So when the Lord asks us to push back against the darkness, to believe, to stand strong, in our individual faith, we say yes. And as a community, we make an impact. Will you pray with me? Lord God, we love you and we bless you and we thank you. We thank you that your word is true. We thank you that there are people around us all the time to speak that word. to speak that strength, to call us into remembering who we are because of who you are. Lord God, root your word and your spirit so deeply inside each of us that when we hear your voice, when we hear the angel of the Lord speak, when we come into your presence, we know and we respond with confidence. That the world might be transformed for the glory of the Lord God in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Sleep, my son. This manger for your bed. You have a long road before you. Rest your little head. Can you feel the weight of your glory? Does the Father God your heart for now so you can sleep tonight? Go to sleep, my son. Go and chase your dreams. This world can wait. For one more moment, go and sleep in peace. I believe the glory of the Father is lying in my arms tonight. Lord, I ask that He, for just this moment,
as we come into a time of prayer, I invite you to just take a moment in the stillness of your own spirit and confess before God those places that we have broken God's heart this week, where we have silenced his nudging and his voice, where we have responded and reacted in ways that broke God's heart. And just take a moment to confess, knowing and trusting, believing that we are loved unconditionally, and that God brings restoration. God brings our redemption. And no matter our fault or failure, we are invited into the throne room of grace to make our needs known to the Lord. We begin by lifting those in our community who need God's intervention to alter their circumstances, to bring healing. And so we lift Tom and Trish, Norma and Louise, Bob, Marilyn, Ryan, Maya, Yoko, Gina, Marilyn, Jean, Jason, Mary Beth, Annalise, Renita, Sandy, Dawn, Donna, Edna, Terry, Mary, Sarah, Shan, Dwayne, HJ, Mike, Eddie, Christina, Mark, Jeanette, Michael, Marianne, Simon, David, Carson. I invite you to take a moment and enter in your prayer requests into the thread, that you would allow your church family, your brothers and sisters in Christ, to pray for you. We are not anonymous in our online worship. We are still the body of Christ. We are still our individual yeses. We are still the prayers of the people lifted together. That we are still community. Lord, as we lift our individual needs to you, we pray for our community. We pray for the valley as we see a rise in cases, diagnoses, and deaths. God, that you would bring healing, that you would protect our medical professionals and our first responders, that you would guard and guide our police and fire and emergency tech. For unity in our country, for our military, for those who serve for the greater good and sacrifice most personally for those who will never be able to say thank you. For those who feel trapped in their circumstances, Lord, you show them that there is always a way. And would you show us how to be the way? For those who are struggling with the isolation and depression and anxiety, with their mental and emotional health, God, I pray that you would bring healing and deliverance, that you would make sure that they have the need and the health care and the support that they need. For those who are struggling to provide for their families, God, would you release the storehouses of heaven and teach your children to give all that we have so that none would have need. God, for those who are wrestling with grief and loss, God, for those facing a holiday season, perhaps for the first time without loved ones, would you bring hope? Would you fill them with your presence and your spirit for those who are dealing with anger, who are frustrated and tired and don't know how to release and find peace, to receive peace. God, I pray you would come with healing and deliverance. For those struggling with addictions, God, would you deliver them? Would you put the right people to bring and lead them into wholeness in their path? And for those who need to celebrate, would you drop moments of joy that are undeniable gifts from you? Would you open our eyes to see that there is much to be celebrated? God, for those places inside us that are so deep that we don't know how to even express what we need. We are so tied up with the emotion. It is so raw that we don't have words for it. God, we invite you by the power of your Holy Spirit to search and to seek, to shine a light. And we trust you with those places, Lord God. You are worthy. You are already working and moving on behalf of our good. We love you and we bless you, and it's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
As we prepare to come to the table, it is a communion Sunday, and so we will be sharing in a time of communion. I invite you to gather elements, anything that you have at home, any bread, juice, any beverage, whatever it is you have, bring to the table. And I will extend the consecration to include whatever it is that you have with you. So just take a moment to do that now. This is normally the time in our service where I would invite you to bring your gifts and offerings to the Lord to make your tithe, and I do encourage you to do that. To continue to give to the church is vitally important for the health and ministry of the church as we look at how soon and how quickly we can reopen to gather in person. But the church has never been closed. I want to remind us that the church is the church. We haven't been able to gather together, but the church is still doing the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so because you are faithful in your giving and you have been tremendously generous, the church has continued to serve and to bless in the name of Jesus Christ this entire year. So what else is it that the Lord might require of us? I invite you just to take a moment as we prepare our hearts to come to the table, that you would invite the Lord to show you what it is he would like from you. What sacrifice of self, what place of forgiveness, what moment or opportunity to be giving of yourself that God is asking for. I invite you to do that now as we come and prepare to receive at the table. In this season of expectant waiting, we are invited to Christ's table here and now. Coming to Christ's table is a way to experience the grace of God. Therefore, it is open to all. The only requirement is a sincere heart. The only barriers to the table created are created in our own heart. So we come together as a people to confess our sins to God, and we confess as a people that we all fall short of God's plan of perfect love. We do not confess to avoid punishment. We confess to free our own hearts and minds so we may remove the barriers we build between ourselves and God and our brothers and sisters. We confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We go about our lives as if Christmas is an event to be celebrated, but not lived. We hear the good news, but do not heed it. We turn away the Holy Family, for there is no room in our hearts. We hear the cry of the expectant mother, desperate for care and a place to lie, but listen instead to Christmas carols. We see the lowly children born in mangers among the filth of the world, but we look instead to decorations. We hear the call of the angels to come and worship the newborn king, but we bow down to the idols of our own culture. Forgive us, we pray. Forgive us and free us for joyful obedience. Remove the barriers that we construct and empower us to be a people doing the real, gritty, holy, grace-filled, loving work of Christmas every day. In the name of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Out of the wilderness, a voice calls out, "Prepare the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way of love. Prepare ye the way of forgiveness." The Christ child was born in the midst of darkness. The waiting is over. Christ may be born today in our hearts. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are all forgiven. Joy to the world. The Lord is with us, and we lift up our hearts. It is our right and our joy and our privilege to give thanks and praise to the Lord, and it is good. It is good to give our thanks and praise. It is good to be joyful always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You create the world from chaos. By simply speaking, you set the cosmos in motion. You created all things from the dust and the stars. Blessed are you, O God the Father, creator of heaven and earth. God of many blessings, you called out a family to be a blessing to all families of the earth. You gave them land and promised to make them a great nation so that all of the nations of the world could be blessed. Blessed are you, God of Abraham and Sarah. You promised the coming of the Anointed One who would lead the people to peace and righteousness. You promised that the descendant of David would rule forever. You promised out of Bethlehem would come the Prince of Peace. You promised the coming of your kingdom when swords would be beaten into plows and spears into pruning hooks. But let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. John the Baptist came telling the people to change your hearts and lives. Hear the kingdom of heaven. John wore clothes made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. He ate locusts and wild honey. People from Jerusalem, throughout Judea, and all around the Jordan River came to him. As they confessed their sins, he baptized them in the Jordan River. And now we come, having confessed our sins, searching for the Holy Spirit to come and fill us expectant grace. We come to be transformed by what has already come and waiting with hope for what is to come. We deck our halls with joy, but it is our hearts that truly matter. We prepare the way of the Lord in our world. Prepare the way of the Lord in our communities. Prepare the way of the Lord in our churches. Prepare the way of the Lord in our hearts. And so, in hopeful anticipation, we give thanks to you, God of creation, God of Abraham and Sarah, God of salvation, God of King David, God of hope and deliverance, God of John, and God of all of us. We join in praise and come together to sing the unending hymn of the saints of glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, Heaven and earth are shining bright with the glory of your light. Loud hosannas now we sing, in the highest they may ring. Blessed is the coming one, Christ Emmanuel, your Son. Glory in the highest, holy God, your name is blessed. Holy are you, and holy is your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the Word made flesh. Holy are you. Holy is your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the one to whom John pointed to in the wilderness. Holy are you, and holy is your Son, Jesus Christ, who was born to us in a manger, for there was no room at the inn. Holy are you, and holy is your Son, Jesus Christ, who came to show us the way to your love. He proclaimed the good news to the poor. He restored sight to the blind. He called the children to his side, taught the women, ate with sinners, and called out the religious leaders blinded by the letter of the law. Holy are you, and holy is your Son, Jesus Christ, who was betrayed by those who loved him, who was persecuted by those who feared him, who was crucified by those who thought that his death would be the end of him. Holy are you, and holy is your Son, Jesus Christ, who on this night in which he gave himself up for us, took bread, gave you thanks and broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in memory of me." And when the supper was over, took the cup and again gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us, gathered by your Holy Spirit, and on these gifts of bread and cup, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Make us a Christmas people, secure in what has come and hopeful for what is yet to be. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. Keep us vigilant in our Advent waiting until Christ comes in final victory, that we may feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Take and eat.
At this table, everyone is welcome. At this table, everyone is seen. At this table, everybody matters. No one falls between. At this table, you could say whatever. At this table, you could speak your mind. Remember that the door is always open. At this table, everybody cares. At this table, everybody matters. So come, pull up a chair.
Pray with me, church family. Lord God, we receive. We sit together as family, and perhaps we arrived at the table as strangers. Maybe we came to the table angry with someone, but here and now, sitting, feasting, celebrating, remembering. God, we are your sons and daughters, and we are transformed by the power and the miracle of a holy meal, in which we remember your sacrifice and your love for us. Fill us, remind us that there is room for everyone, there is plenty, none need go hungry, and that all are welcome. Give us strength in faith and in waiting. It's in the name of the Lord Jesus we pray. Amen.
Come, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel, shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, great Lord of might, who to thy tribes on Sinai's height in ancient times once gave the law. In cloud and majesty and awe, rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel. Shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, O King of David, come and open wide our heavenly home. The captives from their prison free, and conquer death's deep misery. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel, shall come to thee, O Israel.
Thank you for spending this time in worship together. Thank you for being present and being faith-filled, being reminders of God's goodness and faithfulness to his children and his people. I pray that you will receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord turn his face to you and give you favor. The Lord lift his face to you and give you his shalom, his peace. Amen.